Greetings from St. Joseph's College of Commerce. The BBA department presents Spotlight, Season 2, Episode 3. People, pests, and plants. You are what you eat. So is there anybody who would like to start today's topic?
Okay, so we are going to basically discuss upon the fact that plants pest people. We all know that fertilizers and pesticides, of course, they're meant to yield the crop and like enhance growth of the plant and in like in terms of the size and everything, but there are so many harmful effects of pesticides and fertilizers that many people don't seem to know about, and which we're going to highlight upon.
So recent studies have found that the ideal pH level for a plant to grow is between 5.5 to 8. So most of these pesticides and fertilizers aim to reach that particular pH level. But the dangers it poses includes polluting the underground water table, also something called root damage, which affects the plant root, and several other health complications such as respiratory problems. And recent studies have also found it's linked to cancer. So a lot of the people who are actually working on these agricultural fields and treating pesticides and fertilizers are putting their lives at risk. Not only does it pose the issue of health damage, there's also the problem of cost. So most of the foods that we get are priced so because of these pesticides and fertilizers. So we can greatly reduce on cost as well if we, you know, cut down or curb the use of pesticides and fertilizers.
Now, as Rohan touched upon the cost of the thing, I'd like to talk in special reference about the Indian Green Revolution, which basically started in the 1960s, which allowed our Indian farmers to catch up to the global leaders in crop growing and yield, which basically led to our crops having a lot more yield. We had better practices, better machinery, and this did cost a lot, which meant that there was a difference in some farmers towards the others. That is that GMO crops such as cotton and corn was more profitable, which because had more yield, which led to those regions and farmers of those regions getting more profits than the farmers of other regions who had crops that still weren't technologically to that level yet.
I'm so glad Swami brought up the Green Revolution, and he also focused upon the villagers who were benefited from the high yielding crops. Now, on the other hand, the other farmers who didn't have the technical knowledge to withstand or to the practices to actually grow these crops and know how to get the most out of them, were really they didn't get the benefits of them. They it was more of a, you know, it's an opposite effect on them. They didn't yield as much, and this acted as they didn't yield as much, and they couldn't profit from what they made. So they were on a deficit, and that really harmed most of the farmers of our country. And Sharon, do you have anything to say?
Yeah, so another important thing about the farmers in specific is the fact that pesticides also have a harmful effect on the farmers rather than the people, because farmers have to work continuously with pesticides to help them grow, and these pesticides cause multiple health issues to these farmers, which in turn are very harmful to both the consumers as well as the farmers working with the pesticides.
So we've spoken at length about how pesticides have like a carcinogen effect, and it's very harmful for the consumers that eat products that have pesticides applied on them and whatnot. But I would like to touch upon something. We've come a very long way from being a country that has had to import its grains from abroad to being self-sufficient in that sense. Now, what has actually helped us? The Green Revolution. And in this Green Revolution, pesticides, fertilizers have assisted a lot in making us be self-sufficient. Now, despite this surplus in crop production, one out of every five children in India died due to malnutrition and not having gotten enough grains. Why does this happen? It's because the crops are not being transported to the regions that actually have a deficit. Now, it is the pesticides and it is the fertilizers that end up increasing the shelf life of the crops so that it can reach the people on time and they can consume it. So in that sense, pesticides do help. And for somebody that is dying out of hunger, I don't think these technical terms like pH level and whatnot really makes a difference, because for him, the priority would be to survive for that particular day, to consume grain and stay alive for the next day. So in that sense, pesticides do help in sustaining the crop for a longer period of time and helping an individual meet his short-term requirement. So, yeah.
So touching up on what my friend just said, yeah, that is true. Pesticides have gone a long way towards helping us have more yield. But I think personally that pesticides were just one step of our evolution, and genetically modified foods is the next step. And we need to move towards that, because we've already seen great results with cotton and canola, and we're seeing these crops being accepted in more and more countries, and we're seeing more and more technology going into these. And to be honest, what we need is more investment into the agricultural field, especially in India, in the private sector and the public sector, which I think will help.
So I would like to agree with my friend Rajat here about the fact that pesticides are actually helpful in our country, because as we know, India is no more the land of soil. Like, obviously we have alluvial soil and other kinds of soil, which is really fertile in our country, but seeing the environmental conditions in our, like, prevalent in our country, we could definitely say that the soil doesn't hold that much nutrition which would be enough for the plants, and that's the reason why we are using pesticides nowadays.
But at what cost? Because when you use pesticides, it seeps inside the underground water, which is used by many people, and it's also used by the soft drink companies. They use the underground water, which is contaminated, to make their drinks. And the world average for contaminated food is 2%, but in India it's 20%. So 20% of the food samples are contaminated, and that is what we have tested. There's a lot of untested food also. In India, basically, we have two bodies, the CDI and IC. They make regulations for what kind of pesticides you can use. So say for sugarcane, if there are 12 pesticides, the farmers, they stick to those 12 pesticides. But the levels of the limits is what, how much you can use that to is not specified, which is the MCA, I'm guessing. And since the limits are not specified, the farmers use it.
I think instead of, you know, letting them not use pesticides, we can basically help them to understand how much they should use and make them literate enough so that they can know the exact quantity to be used and how to use them. There are so many different techniques of farming which are coming up, which India is actually adopting, the Israeli technique and so many different techniques. We can actually educate them about that and make it more efficient for them, rather than not letting them use pesticides at all. The right amount will be sufficient.
Okay, in response to what he said that for a common man, it wouldn't matter about the pH level or any of that, because they just care about that day's meal. But here's a thought. Since GMO has come out recently, there hasn't been much research done on the same. But there's another alternative theory called marker selective address. What marker selective addressing does is it narrows down the component that you want to alter in the plant. So you need not necessarily involve the use of pesticides, fertilizers. And for the Indian requirement, which is estimated at, I think, around 3,000 million tons by 2025, it isn't just going to work with pesticides and fertilizers, because let's face it, it's a problem of short term versus long term. Now, for that day's meal, it's a short term concern, but I think we should firmly look at the long term aspects of this, what health problems it can pose in the future. It says that, you know, around 42% of our country uses 27% of fertilizers, farming-wise at least. So for an agro-based economy like ours, if we are using fertilizers at such an alarming rate, I think the health damages it can pose are tremendous.
Coming back to the harmful effects of pesticides, it is known that the chemicals that are in the pesticides and fertilizers are known to pollute the groundwater level, and this obviously has many health effects, because in a country where pollution is a major issue, pesticides just add to our trouble.
So yeah, agreed. I'm not saying that pesticides are essentially good for consumption, but completely stopping the usage would be extremely alarming. So I think somewhere in between, the approach should be that we should have like a consistent decrease every year in the amount of dependence that we have on pesticides, because that way we will not be compromising on the short-term goal, that is ensuring that every child has a meal every single day, and there is no wastage of crop because of substances not being used to increase its sustainability. So every single year we must spend a lot of money on research to look at other alternatives as compared to pesticides to increase the sustainability of the crop and thereby decrease the dependence on the pesticide by a certain amount every single year, until we can probably be like hands-free out of pesticides. That way we have focused on the short-term goal, keeping the long term in perspective. And yeah.
Just to end with pesticides, I think we right now we're at a point where we're very dependent on pesticides. But GMOs are just getting into the global market. I don't think we've looked into them enough. I don't think we've researched them enough as a country. So getting into GMOs, investing, I think investment into the agriculture, considering how we are an agro-based economy, I don't think we invest nearly enough as we need to into the agricultural industry. So investment will definitely help us. And moreover, to touch upon what Rohan said about short-term versus long-term, I think that's very important, because we have the biggest youth population in the world. And how this youth is fed is very important if we are to become a global superpower, because we need to have a youth that is healthy at the end of the day, to have a productive youth.
I think Swami is extremely right, and not enough money goes into the research for agricultural uses, and we have the largest youth population, and it really matters on how they are fed. Also, something like Rohan said, there are better processes than just GMOs, and I think one thing which needs to be focused on how it's regulated. There has to be more research on the fact how much can be used, how much can be done, because that is where we lose out. Even now the fertilizers, there is a set amount, but how much set number of fertilizers which can be used, but there is no set amount. Now that's how things get abused, and that's how we fall out of normal processes, and that's how we lose out.
So thanks guys for all your valuable points with regard to pesticides and caring about the farmers. But then when it comes to genetically modified food, right? Scientists have a way of going about it, but the public thinks that scientifically modified food or genetically modified food is considered to be Frankenfoods, as they say. So in this day of age of healthy eating and having a healthy lifestyle, do you think GMO is the way to go with regard to making your food or getting your food from the farmers? Any pointers?
I'd like to absolutely agree with you about Frankenfoods. In response to your question, I don't think GMO is the way forward, because besides the fact that it's a recently introduced concept, there are a lot of theories that have come out which say otherwise. So what GMOs plan to do is basically increase the crop yield and productivity in the long run. But I think traditional methods which have worked for us in the past, like alfalfa tablets, manure composting, all these are proven, and they yield like high variety crops such as wheat, millet, which is actually extremely nutritious. In most government schools, they have programs which offer wheat and millet as a three-course meal, and the nutrition in those schools has risen, research proves. So I think even though there has to be some more research done into GMOs, but I'd like to think that processes like I mentioned earlier, like material processing and all such other processes which only alter one component of the plant or focus specifically on one component without posing any health benefits is a more viable solution.
I'd like to slightly disagree there, because the point being that there just hasn't been enough research done into GMO, because there hasn't been enough support from the start. GMO has been, I think a lot of people have a lot of mistrust in science, and I think that mistrust is not found. It's not grounded in anything that is, I think, that we should support. And I say that because in the healthcare industry, at the very least, there's been bacteria known to have evolved in our lifetime, to have evolved to avoid antibiotics that we take. So if bacteria can evolve, so can every other form of pests that affect plants. So I think if they can evolve, we have to evolve our crops too. I think that's an important point, and that we need to support this.
Another important point would be the fact that GMO takes a really long time to be processed. It takes about 30 years to come into effect, and it does play a huge role, because besides science being given an opportunity or not, the fact is that we have a huge population and it needs to be fed, and taking such a long time won't help us in any way.
I don't think time is a factor here. Obviously it is, but we are not going to immediately substitute them for the current growing crops. Now the current growing crops are going to be there, and parallelly we will involve this process into the normal growth of crops. And I completely agree with what Swami says. We need to evolve along with what evolves around us. Otherwise, the selective process will take us out.
government resources shouldn't just be directed towards agriculture. Additional resources should also be directed towards the awareness, spreading awareness about pesticides, at what limits you should be using them, and how do you use them to get the maximum production. Along with that, we should also use these resources for research and development purposes, because only when we have developed and known enough about these GMOs will we be telling the public about it.
Another important thing that hasn't been discussed is the fact that there are a lot of people who are not aware of GMOs, and because of the fact that it's not publicized as much as it should be, and there are countries in which people demand that GMO products should be certified with a label, and that makes absolute sense because a lot of the general people are not aware of GMO and its effects.
Okay, I think what she's brought up a really important point to do with labeling. I would like to agree that not many people are aware of GMO and the benefits or whatever hazards they pose. But also in response to what Swami said, if you GMOs haven't, there's not much scope for research on GMOs because it's a recent concept and all of that. But for a process, like there have been two or three other processes tested by the NDPA, which actually they went personally to the soil and, you know, did soil tests. So I think a lot of it has to do with soil testing as well. Most of these GMOs and, you know, the use of even pesticides and fertilizers for that case is done without soil tests, and these farmers aren't really educated. So I think a lot of education should be given to these farmers to adapt to these techniques, and then we can move further with the process of labeling and making the other people aware. But it starts with the farmers. I think making them aware of the process and, you know, its benefits or the hazards it could pose is the first step.
Adding to what my friend said, it's all down to the farmers, but here's the issue. In India, the problem is that farmers are not concerned about anything more than loan waivers and all of that. They always seem to be entrapped in this debt trap all the time. So I think the government should do a lot with this regard. Like, the agenda for every farmer should be a lot more than getting his loan waivered and whatnot. He should be looking at educating himself about the latest possible techniques. He should realize that he's not living in the stone ages anymore. Like, the world has moved forward, and even the farmer does have a right to move forward. And a lot of this, the government should also do its bit in not only waiving the loans. Yeah, it's obviously very important that a part of his debt burden is reduced, but at the same time, farmer education, not just with regard to you know, using of pesticides and all of that, but like intensive scientific education must be provided to them.
So we all know how GMOs work basically. So if, for example, a plant was to say to be frost tolerant, let's say for example spinach, that gene would be taken from a fish that lives in icy waters and instilled in a plant. Alright, and that's how the plant becomes frost tolerant. The same way, there have been many instances over the years where we've had examples of foods that come into benefiting us. So do you think that using pesticides and GMOs actually benefit us in a way, or is it a disadvantage to our own health and being?
Well, I think GMOs in our ever, with our population ever increasing, is actually helpful to us because it helps match our food demand. And I say that because we've seen in countries like the US, corn grown in the US, 93% of all corn grown in the US has been genetically modified in one way or another. And that's very important because 93% is a very high number. And this goes into corn syrup and even canola or in cooking oil. There's 60 or 70% genetically modified. Now, this is a huge number in a very big country. And I think this is a very good thing going forward for genetically modified food. Although I do think that these foods need to be labeled, because I think people deserve the choice of opting out of genetically modified food if they wish to not consume certain things.
Another important point that I'd like to add to what my friend said is that there has been a myth about saying that GMOs contribute to a lot of health issues, but the fact is that in over 20 years there hasn't been a single death caused from any GMO used product. Also, another really important point is that GMOs actually reduce the real cost of food rather than increasing it. which is believed to be another myth, where they say that GMOs increase your pricing.
Now, Sharon, I'd like to disagree. When you say there is no real, it's not the cause of death, surely it's one of the causes of death, because it compounds into something bigger, right? It's not the exact, no one has sued a cigarette company for giving them cancer, but the radiation somehow gives them the cancer anyway. So I don't think that it is very safe for somebody, but I think research, as research develops and we grow as human beings and everybody evolves, it'll be the way forward. Innovation is required in agriculture.
In response to what my friend Sharon said, even though there have been no recent cases of deaths or whatever, that's again a long-term perspective. But coming to the fact of gene alteration, there have been cases of GMOs where, you know, the wrong gene has been altered or the expected growth result is not seen. So let's take the case of soya beans. In a recent production, I think in Milwaukee, there was a wrong gene introduced into the soya bean. And so the production of it went haphazard. So more than talking about the health concerns, let's talk about the amount of wastage of food. Granted that GMO is a recent concept and it's going to take time for people to adapt to it, but I think we cannot come to a definite opinion until we expose ourselves more to these kind of techniques or explore other alternatives. Sunflower, soybean, maize, wheat, all of these have been altered by GMO, but we still can't reach a certain conclusion as to the health hazards it poses. But a few more years of research and we might arrive at that.
Like it was mentioned earlier, specific genes are used and, say, infused with, for example, the fish extract is infused, maybe a gene is infused with corn, and that's not something that is going to be accepted, for example, in the case of vegetarians, because they're not going to accept it. There are people who are very strict about their religion and what they eat, and this doesn't help in every case.
Adding on to what Sanam and Rohan said, yeah, it is true that genetically modified might not be the only way forward, might not be the right way forward. But I think right now we're going down a path where we don't know where the destination is, and we can't conclusively, as he said, we can't conclusively decide. So I think we need to research on all fronts, not just focus on one path, that is GMO, maybe focus on other alternatives as well. But I think the main major focus is that we do focus on these things and not just be happy where we are with pesticides, because pesticides are definitely not something that we can sustain. And adding on to what Sanam said, yes, we definitely do need to label these crops, because I think people who do not believe, I think there are a lot of people who eat organic, who grow their own food and fruits, I think they deserve, if they do wish to consume certain things, they should know what's in what they're consuming. So I think we really need to label these foods accordingly and give people the choice to opt out of genetically modified or any other form of, aspects.
Another point I'd like to bring up is the fact that many countries believe that GMOs will help their farmers, but I think the farmers know themselves the best for their crops. So if they believe that GMOs help and they actually see results which help them to believe that GMO is actually favoring them, I think they should be allowed to use it.
Thanks so much, guys. So to wrap it up, basically, okay, the FSSAI, which is the Food Regulatory Body of India, has currently banned GMOs in the country. Do you think the government of India should give GMOs a chance, or should we go the same way as we've been going throughout the years with regard to pesticides and fertilizers?
Well, I do think the government should give GMOs a chance, but not by letting it go unregulated, but rather encourage private investment in the thing, as the US has done. US has a lot of private investors in the agricultural industry, and we don't have nearly enough. So if we promote more private investors to come, do more research, help regulate industry more, I think that'll help GMO and help the industry as a whole as well.
Also, I think the government should make it a point for people to use GMO, because whether or not the government allows it, there are going to be people who are going to use it. And as much as it sounds against the rules of the country, against the policies, it is what is going to happen. And like many other substances in the country, not everyone is waiting for the government's approval. Like, they're doing it anyway.
I'm glad Sanam brought that up. Banning really doesn't curb the use of the substance or the product. And according to the Vox research of 2014, there is still 17% of, somewhere around 17% of the country, which farmers, I mean, who still use GMOs for their, I mean, still use GMOs to produce yield. And to actually curb it or rather regulate it, we need a lot of investment, like Swami stated.
I would like to agree with the point of research. A lot more research has to be delved into this. But also I would like to bring up the point of comparative research. I feel like there's more scope than to solely study the GMO, to study two or three different techniques simultaneously and let the farmers test this for themselves. So, like, for example, marker selective assistance, GMO, and probably another technique can be reviewed at the same time so that they can reach a concrete conclusion. Just leveling it down and not making it available to the country, I think, is a wrong move, because people need to get to know about it and adapt to it. Even there's a lot of time that people need to get used to it. So I think that GMOs and marker selective assistance is the way out to curb pesticides and fertilizers. So I think that's the bigger picture here, that GMOs and marker selective assistance should be given a chance, you know, to avoid possible health complications that could arise either in the long term or in the short term.
In the end, I would like to conclude by saying that I would like to agree with my friend here about the GMO research, because as of now, our country hasn't spent or like is not aware of GMO as such. So we should actually try GMO in a very contained environment under specific regulations, and if it's actually viable for the farmers to use, and then we can actually educate them about that.
Thank you guys so much for all your valuable inputs, and I guess we can bring this to a wrap. So, thanks once again for joining us here today. The BBA Department presents Spotlight Season 2, Episode 3, Plants, Pests, People.